Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to today's I Play for Peace International Armistice Day concert, which is here for the second year at Edinburgh Napier's Craig Lockhart campus, the site of the Officers' Military War Hospital during the First World War. Last year we convened to hear Thorin Ferguson's composition, Armistice, played in harmony across the world. The composition was scored on the Wilfred Owen violin, an instrument brought to us by violin maker Steve Burnett. It was made from a tree in the grounds of Craig Lockhart campus. The violin has been endorsed by UNICEF as an ambassador for peace through the power of music. And Wilfred Owen's words and his inspiration continue on 102 years after Owen and the war poets were patients in this building. Having marked 100 years after the First World War, the Armistice centenary, today's concert sets the scene of the post-Armistice world and the peace which people endeavoured to seek after the war. Our talented participants, our musicians, and our academic input from Professor McEwen will give an insight to the lives in the post-war world. We will do that through music, narrative, and poetry. Much work goes into commemorating conflict, and that must continue for 100 years more after this day. But we must also give some effort to promote the peace that follows. A little over 100 years ago, Wilfred Owen and Siegfried Sassoon met here at Craig Lockhart, and together they received treatment from shell shock, but also were inspired to write some of the most powerful words about war in this very building. The War Poets Collection warmly welcomes visitors from across the world and across the country, and Catherine Walker, MBE, the War Poets Curator, will later give us an insight to the work that goes on in the building today and went on 100 years ago. Our compositions today are very appropriate. One of them, from Paul Anderson, is inspired by the medics and the nurses of war, who ultimately continued their work even though the war had come to an end. As many of you know, the I Play for Peace School's outreach programme has been working with school students from Sighthill Primary School, and they have visited the War Poets Collection on many occasions, and they're here with us today. They've been learning about the powerful impact of creative therapies that Dr. Brock and Dr. Rivers practiced here at Craig Lockhart. And we're delighted to welcome Primary 7 pupils Kayla, Sophie and Fatima, who are later going to read poems from the War Poets for us. We're also delighted to welcome George Watson's College Captain, and we've got Lachlan White, who is also going to read to us today. He is going to read the very pertinent story of former Watson's pupil, Robert Rutherford Brydon, who inspired the very first minute's silence. We warmly welcome the Edinburgh Chamber Orchestra, who will perform today with the music director Alberto Massimo, not only leading the concert here, but also leading a global orchestra who will join us later on this afternoon via our online connections and links. They will play two pieces, one composed by Anthony White and one composed by Paul Anderson, which have been set and shared with an international online orchestra. Edinburgh Napier University leads on cutting-edge, immersive, multimedia location connections. That's easy for me to say. I had to really check there. The project has got a nice and short title, though, called Ensemble. And ultimately, what we have is an ability to project our performance today to the west coast of the USA, to Berlin, to Belgium, and we also have a number of locations who've already joined us this morning. We've had Japan, South Africa, Russia, we've had London, just to name a few of the locations who are playing alongside us today. The performances are also part of the Now Net Arts Conference, which Edinburgh Napier is proud to serve as a satellite site. And it brings together performers, technologists, researchers and educators, all to advance the field of contemporary arts and connectivity. The research project explores how musicians can participate in performances whilst they're separated by long distances, and clearly South Africa, America are significant distances apart. Experiencing the live concert as you are today is clearly the top experience and a valuable cultural experience. However, as we know, the costs involved, not only financial but environmentally, are significant. And as such, Ensemble looks to provide new technology to give solutions to that problem, but also to give us other creative opportunities, such as we have here today, where we have international musicians playing together at the same time. With regards to that, my thanks go to you, and he'll be beavering away at the back somewhere and may not hear me, but Professor Paul Ferguson and his team, who are very kindly supporting in the background, but also to Dr. Kirsten McLeod, Francis Todd, and Ben Taylor, and all their teams who are supporting today's concert. The concert has been filmed, it's been lit, and it's also been audio engineered by students from Edinburgh Napier's School of Arts and Creative Industries. And we're delighted that today gives an opportunity not only to showcase their work, to showcase the work of school students, to showcase a university's work, and to showcase adult learners' work in a truly international concert. As part of coordinating today, I'd like to pay tribute to one more individual. And it's an individual who works away behind the scenes and doesn't always get the credit that he deserves. And he works tirelessly in a committed way and in a very, very quiet way. And he's somewhere behind there just now. It's Mr. Gary Seath. Gary's work not only supporting education, but supporting commemoration and supporting veterans is truly outstanding and inspiring. At this point, I'd like us all to put our hands together and thank Mr. Gary Seath. Thanks to Gary and the huge team that I've outlined to you who are here today in international locations, we have an intergenerational project, we have an interdisciplinary project, and we have an international project. We have no barriers today, only connections. I sincerely hope you enjoy the concert today. Ladies and gentlemen, can I please introduce our music director for today, Alberto Massimo, and the Edinburgh Chamber Orchestra, who are going to start us today with Thorin Ferguson's Armistice. Thank you very much.
everyone sang. Everyone suddenly burst out singing, and it filled me with such delight, as prison birds must find in freedom, winging wildly across the white orchards and dark green fields, on and out of sight. Everyone's voices were suddenly lifted, and beauty came like the setting sun. My heart was shaking with tears, and horror drifted away. Oh, but everyone was a bird, and the song was wordless. The singing will never be done.
In 1914, at the outbreak of war, they said it would all be over by Christmas or before the leaves fall. It wasn't, and it lasted until 1919. The personal and social consequences would last for years. In 1918, the November Armistice took place, and we were remembering our dead servicemen and women, and a month later we had a general election. According to Lloyd George, the Prime Minister, and his election manifesto, Britain would be a land fit for heroes, and he would build homes for heroes. This manifesto gave great hope to a war-weary, depressed nation, but the election promises were only partially fulfilled. In 1919, the Paris Peace Treaty was signed, and the war was officially over. But a war isn't over when it's over, and peace does not bring peace. By 1920, And between 1920 and 1936, there was a great economic depression. Unemployment and poverty became the norms. The following are comments from a child and an adult who, in post-war social Britain, mirrored the effects of exactly what was happening. The first one is from a child living here in Scotland. There was 12 of us, 6 sons, 6 daughters, but 2 died at an early stage. Our house was lit with paraffin lamps, and we lived in 2 rooms. We had a stone floor, and my mother used to make patterns on the floor with chalk. We had an outside toilet and no bath. Before I left for school, my mother used to give me tea to take to a soldier. He lived in a wee hut in the woods. We gave him soup and tea to keep him going. Sometime I took him cigarettes from people in the village. The next one was a police report that was filed, and it was filed by a police sergeant who actually to prove a man, a veteran, and his family were suffering hardship. This man was a private in the machine gun corps. He served for 2 years at the front. He and his wife and 3 children aged 6, 4, and 2. They're in arrears with their rent. They receive a pint and a half of milk per day, and every 2 weeks they get a stone and a half of meal from the Board of Health. He has no other means of support. His wife and children are in rags, have no boots or shoes, and several articles of bed clothing are in the pawn. This is a truly deserving case. Remembrance, I believe, should not just be about the dead. It should be remembrance of how heinous, tragic, and traumatic war can be and the devastating effects it has on individuals, families, and communities. So no, a war is not over when it's over, and peace does not bring peace. This we should remember.
Of the 249 states in the Holy Roman Empire. 90% of the population of the Black Forest was eliminated, and so was 50% between Pomerania. The war still ranks as one of the worst of famines and plagues, and is called the greatest medical catastrophe in modern European history. Just one army, the Swedish alone, destroyed 18,000 villages, and 1,500 German towns were razed to the ground. The illnesses and mental illnesses that took place for the next two generations made it all the more difficult for smaller states like the ducal court of Curtin to recover. And it was really only with Bach going there in 1714 to compose these pieces that really the country had started to recover. Bach's third orchestral suite, we're going to play you the air.
Dulce et Decorum Est by Wilfred Owen. Bent double, like old beggars under sacks. Not need, coffin like hags. We cursed through sludge, till on the haunting flares we turned our backs and towards their distant rest began to trudge. Men marched asleep. Many had lost their boots but limped on, bloodshot. All went lame, all blind. Drunk with fatigue, deaf even to the hoots of tired, outstripped 5-9s that dropped behind. Gas, gas, quick boys. An ecstasy of fumbling, found the clumsy helmets just in time. But someone still was yelling out and stumbling, and floundering like a man in fire line. Dim, through the misty panes and thick green light, as under a green sea, I saw him drowning. In all my dreams before my helpless sight, he plunges at me. Guttering, choking, drowning. If in some smothering dreams you too could pace behind the wagon that we follow him in, and watch your white eyes writhing in his face, his hanging face, like a devil that's sick of sin. If you could hear every jolt, the blood come gargling from the froth-corrupted lungs, obscene as cancer, bitter as the cut of vile, incurable sores on innocent tongues. My friend, you will not tell with such high zest the children ardent for some desperate glory, the old lie. Dulce et decorum est pro patria mori.
Thank you, Sophie. Good afternoon, everyone. Edinburgh Napier University purchased Craig Lockhart campus in the mid-1980s. We knew that the building had a fascinating history and recognised that we had acquired a piece of the past. The building opened as a hydropathic establishment in 1880. It was then requisitioned for use by the military as a hospital in 1916. And in 1920, this building became a convent and teacher training college and school. So in many respects, this campus has long associations with healthcare, education, and compassion. Today, we particularly remember Craig Lockhart War Hospital. The hospital had 174 beds and treated a total of 1,801 officers, mostly suffering from neurasthenia, more commonly known as shell shock. However, the admissions book also records gunshot wounds, gas poisonings, and fractures. The officers were not necessarily local or even Scottish. Many were from far from home, some from as far away as Canada. The work of the doctors was groundbreaking for the time. The therapies used here to treat neurasthenia one century ago by doctors Brock, Rivers, McIntyre, and the American doctor, Arthur Ruggles, remain relevant today. We also remember the work of Matron McBean and the professional nurses and VADs, who were subjects of photographs and poems, all published in the Hydra, the magazine of the War Hospital. The hospital's most famous patients were, of course, the poets Wilfred Owen and Siegfried Sassoon, who met here in August 1917. As a result of their friendship, Sassoon and Owen have left us with an important poetic legacy, and their words ultimately influenced our view of the war. Within these walls, some of the greatest poetry of the First World War was inspired and written, poems such as those that you've just heard read by Sophie, Wilfred Owen's gas poem, Dulce et Decorum Est. In addition to the remarkable poetry, the poets also left us descriptive prose, letters and diaries, and they provided us with a glimpse of hospital life. Wilfred Owen was admitted to Craig Lockhart on the 26th of June 1917. He wrote to his mother, "A taxi brought me here, about 2.5 miles from the town. There is nothing very attractive about the place. It is a decayed hydro, far too full of officers, some of whom I know." Wilfred Owen was treated by a local doctor, Dr. Arthur Brock, who used ergotherapy, the work cure, to reconnect damaged officers back to a familiar environment through worthy activities. This therapy seemed particularly to work for Wilfred Owen. Our Dr. Brock is described as being full of energy. He kept everyone busy
including those patients who preferred a long lie in bed rather than a brisk walk before breakfast. Sassoon was a decorated officer, bold and reckless, earning him the nickname Mad Jack. Despite this, Sassoon protested against the continuance of the war, refusing to return to duty in an act of willful defiance of military authority. Those same authorities were persuaded that Sassoon must be suffering from the mental strains of warfare. He was sent to Craiglockhart War Hospital in July 1917, rather than being court-martialed. Sassoon was reassured by a member of the medical board who said, "Rivers will look after you when you get there." Dr. William Rivers, an eminent Cambridge University psychologist, used psychotherapies and dream analysis to enable the officers to face their traumatic experiences of war. One patient wrote, "Rumour has it that when a fresh convoy arrived, Captain Rivers walked around them and took his pick. Strange to say, nearly all the interesting cases floated his way." In a letter to his friend Robbie Ross, Sassoon referred to the hospital as Dottyville. He wrote, "There are 160 officers here who are all half Dotty." Sassoon also noted that the War Office had wasted no money on interior decoration. By day, the hospital was elaborately cheerful, but at night, Craiglockhart became a live museum of war neurosis. Craiglockhart campus today is home to both the University Business School and the War Poets Collection. The collection acquires information about the history of the campus through the words and memories, photographs and artefacts of the people who lived and worked here during the Great War. The permanent exhibition provides visitors with a glimpse of an insight into our rich heritage. Like so many others, the poets returned to service after their time at Craiglockhart. Siegfried Sassoon survived two world wars, becoming a celebrated poet and writer. He died in 1967. Wilfred Owen was killed in action on the 4th of November, 1918, exactly 1 week before the armistice. His mother received the telegram whilst the armistice bells were ringing. Perhaps the final words on the role of Craiglockhart War Hospital in the Great War should be those of Mrs. Maureen Hughes, whose father, John Harry Burns, was treated here in 1917. Lieutenant Burns survived the war, but his wife always used to say, "Without Craiglockhart, we might never have got Daddy back."
The piece on the programme is by Sir Edward Elgar. In 1879, he was appointed the conductor of the attendance band of the Worcester County Lunatic Asylum, and so began 5 years of association for him with mental illness. And not only that, he was also appointed professor of violin at the Worcester College for the Blind Sons of Gentlemen, now called the New College. The asylum where he worked had double that of Craiglockhart, 365 patients. And the doctors there were very enlightened and instituted a number of orchestral concerts, as well as the Friday night dances in which the patients took part. And part of Elgar's job was composing music for these dances. Elgar received about £100 a month in today's money for his weekly appearances, as well as £15 for each polka or quadrille that he produced, as well as £5 every time he had to accompany some singing. Elgar, when he wrote this serenade for strings, which was one of his very first great successes, it was indeed the mental patients themselves that gave this piece its first performance.
well as writing powerful war poems whilst here in Edinburgh, Craig Lockhart patient Wilfred Owen also penned a play. The full text of the play is missing, however, the plot survives on Craig Lockhart Hospital headed note paper. Owen set the play in the Lord of Europe's dining room in London. The plot continued with a federation of America with Europe, and it included a secret meeting under the Atlantic reached in a private submarine. It seems a mad, mad play. However, perhaps if you look at today's events, it isn't that mad at all. We might even say Owen was a visionary. Ultimately, Owen continued his recovery, and his recovery was so strong that he was sent back to the front. A year after he had penned that play, he was to die in action. His parents found out the news of his passing on Armistice Day. By early 1919, American President Woodrow Wilson and other world leaders met in the Palace of Versailles near Paris. They hoped to establish a new world order, which would secure the long-term peace of Europe and the world. And at the conference, Wilson proposed his 14 points, point 14 of which linked to Owen's play, a general association of the nations. It must be formed under specific covenants for the purposes of affording mutual guarantees of political independence and of territorial integrity of great and small nations alike. War, as we've heard from Professor McEwen, is complex, it's confusing, and it's catastrophic. The peace of 1918 brought calm after 4 years of carnage. However, making peace is also challenging. As the dust settled, there was a sigh of relief. There was also grieving, and there was also delegations starting to gather to discuss the peace conferences that would follow. As Wilson proposed his plans, Georges Clemenceau, the French premier, faced serious calls to ensure that France got its just for revenge on Germany. British Prime Minister David Lloyd George was under dual pressure to squeeze the German lemon until the pip squeaked, and also those who demanded a firm but a fair peace. Each international leader took with them a delegation of diplomats, experts and translators to try to make sense of the mess the world had left behind. Until recently, it wasn't known that two Scots played a vital part in discussions and diplomacy at that time. James Duncan was born on an Aberdeenshire farm in 1857. Although Aberdeenshire was mainly an agricultural area, Duncan entered the other great profession of granite cutting. And a downturn in the Aberdeen economy, matched with an upsurge of granite cutting needs to memorialise the American Civil War, saw Duncan, along with many other Aberdonians, emigrate to America. Moving to America, Duncan was to join the Granite Cutters Union, and under his leadership, the Granite Cutters secured better working conditions, received better pay, and he also secured the first 8-hour working day. Duncan was then installed as the president of the Granite Cutters Union, but also the second vice president of the American Federation of Labour. In 1917, Woodrow Wilson invited Duncan as a delegate on his route mission to Russia to meet with the revolutionary leaders to try to keep Russia in the First World War. Duncan had clearly acquitted himself well during that mission, as a year later, President Wilson was to choose this Scotsman to travel with him again, this time to the Paris Peace Conference at the Palace of Versailles. There, in the grandeur of the Palace Peace, Palace of Versailles, Duncan was to input to one of the few surviving pieces of the 1919 Treaty of Versailles, and that piece is the International Labour Organization. The clause in the peace treaty and in the League of Nations saw the words social justice inserted into an international treaty for the first time. Duncan was not the only Scot who was to have an impact on thinking around this time. The work of Stonehaven, born James Murdoch, could have changed world events forever. Wilson's self-determination idea hit a stumbling block very early in negotiations at Versailles. Japan, who was Britain's ally, pressed early in negotiations for a race equity clause. However, some of the great powers found it difficult and were reluctant to grant such a request at that time. Wilson planned to give Japan large areas of Chinese territory in lieu of the request for race equity. This in itself broke the concept of self-determination. At the same time, James Murdoch from Stonehaven was playing a vital role in diplomacy. The former journalist and school headmaster was now the professor of Japanese studies at the University of Sydney. Quite a journey to have gone from Stonehaven to become professor of Japanese studies in Sydney, Australia. And now he found himself placed in 1919 in Japan as a spy for Australian military intelligence. And from Japan, he was strongly suggesting the acceptance of the race equity clause. He was trying to push Allied leaders to progress something that we're still trying to progress today. Sadly, equity did not sit easy with the Australian Prime Minister, Billy Hughes, who pursued a white Australia policy. On the 10th of April 1919, Murdoch wrote to the head of military intelligence that something could be done without any unpleasantness. However, if something wasn't done, it was quite possible there would be something worse than just unpleasantness. 2 weeks later, he followed up with another letter warning the Allied leaders that we drive Japan to seek alliances. And if we're not careful, by 1935, Germany, Russia, and Japan will act together. And he warned the next war will be a war of the air, far more than the last one. Murdoch was now predicting the Second World War, and he was also predicting the horrendous air attacks that we know only too well from the Second World War. Whilst Portlethen's James Duncan succeeded in establishing a mechanism for international dialogue, Stonehaven's James Murdoch had tried his best efforts to avert the next war, which, as we know, came in 1939. Today we reflect on the opportunities and, of course, the failure of international peace. We reflect on the impact of social justice, and moreover, we reflect on how we can avoid wars in the future. Our crowdsourced international concert today has musicians across the world playing with no distinction of race, no distinction of age, no distinction of nationality, and no distinction of income nor ability. It's a truly crowdsourced international orchestra that we have. And our musicians demonstrate that creativity and cooperation can overcome conflict.
Of that start of the Second World War just 80 years ago, Hans Gall, the Austro-British composer, died in Edinburgh in 1987, just short of his 100th birthday. He was born to a Jewish family just outside Vienna, and his piano teacher, Richard Robert, had also taught George Searle, Rudolf Serkin and Clara Haskell. Hans was appointed as teacher at the new Vienna Conservatory to become its director. And later on, in 1915, he was the first recipient of the new Austrian State Prize for Composition with his first symphony. In 1929, with the support of great musicians such as Wilhelm Furtwängler, Richard Strauss, and Fritz Busch, he became director of Mainz Conservatory in Germany. However, as soon as the Nazis took power, he was instantly dismissed from this post. He returned to Austria only to find that land taken by the Anschluss. So he had no option but to flee,
to London, where he met the musician and scholar Donald Tovey, who persuaded him to come to Edinburgh and teach at the Reed School of Music. In 1940, he was arrested as an enemy alien. How typical. And interned near Liverpool, much to the consternation of the entire Edinburgh faculty staff. Tovey was to secure his release and become a stalwart supporter of Gal. Our city's musical activities he very much fostered and was one of the founders of the Edinburgh International Festival in 1947. He also was one of my predecessors conducting this orchestra until 1964. In recognition of his time as our orchestral conductor on the 80th anniversary of the start of the Second World War, I would like to dedicate this performance to the plight of refugees worldwide.
Thank you. 2-minute silence on Armistice Day has been observed since the first anniversary of the end of World War I in 1919. But what is perhaps less well known is that the idea for silent reflection came from a Scot who lived in South Africa during the conflict. Robert Rutherford Brydon was born in Edinburgh's Newtown in 1862 and was a pupil at the city's George Watson's College. According to research by writer and educator Joan Abrams, Mr. Brydon emigrated to South Africa when he was 22 and carried out a successful career in insurance. During World War I, Mr. Brydon, by then in his 50s, was a member of the town council in Cape Town. Ms. Abrams' research says Mr. Brydon was actively involved with the recruiting meetings in the city's drill hall. At a meeting they had in early 1915, it is reported a man in the audience said, "You will forget us as soon as we are gone." Mr. Brydon is said to have promised that the city would not forget its sons during their absence. As an outward sign, he arranged a monthly meeting to remember the soldiers fighting in Europe. In early 1918, Mr. Brydon and Cape Town Mayor Sir Harry Hands decided to take the remembrance further. The death of Sir Harry's eldest son in the war led them to consider new ways of marking soldiers' sacrifice. Mr. Brydon suggested the firing of the city's noonday gun could mark a pause in activity, during which people could pray for the men fighting in the war. According to Ms. Abrams, Mr. Brydon and Sir Harry organized an area of the city where the traffic would be brought to a standstill for the duration of the pause, and the first silence was observed at Cartwright's Corner in Adderley Street on the 14th of May, 1918. As soon as the city fell silent, a trumpeter on the balcony of the Fletcher and Cartwright's building on the corner of Adderley and Darling Streets sounded the last post. The reveille was played at the end of the midday pause. Articles in the newspaper described how trams, taxis, and private vehicles stopped, pedestrians came to a halt, and most men bared their heads. The pause was originally 3 minutes, but was reduced to 2 in order to better retain its hold on the people. It was repeated daily for the duration of the war, and only ended in December, after the conclusion of the conflict. The stated aim of the pause was silent remembrance, fulfilling a debt of honor to the fallen, and demonstrating to those who survived that the sacrifice of the dead did not go unnoticed or unappreciated. Another South African, Sir Percy Fitzpatrick, is rightly credited as being the driving force behind the annual 2-minute silence on Armistice Day. He took the idea to King George V, who introduced it on the first anniversary of the end of the war, and it has been repeated around the world ever since. However, Ms. Abrams says that Sir Percy acknowledged that the idea came from Mr. Brydon's Cape Town pause. He said that other towns followed its example, but nothing was as dramatic as the Cape Town observation simply because of the midday gun. In Cape Town, there is a plaque entitled "Commemoration of an Honorable Tradition." It reads, "When the noonday gun was fired from the Lion Battery, Signal Hill, on the 14th of May, 1918, it brought Cape Town to a dead stop for a 2-minute silence. 1 minute in remembrance for those who died for their cause, 1 minute in gratitude for survivors." The idea was initiated by Mr. R.R. Brydon and the mayor of Cape Town, Sir Harry Hands. Sir Percy Fitzpatrick submitted the suggestion to King George V. The 2-minute silence has been observed internationally since 1919 on 11th of November and Remembrance Sunday at 1100 hours. We will now observe a moment's silence to remember those who fell.
Have you forgotten yet? For the world's event have rumbled on since those gagged days, like traffic checked a while at crossing of cityways, and the haunted gap in your mind has filled with thoughts that flow like clouds in the lit heaven of life. And you're a man, reprieved to go, taking your peaceful share of time with joy to spare. But the past is just the same, and war's a bloody game. Have you forgotten yet? Look down and swear by the slain of the war that you'll never forget. Do you remember the dark months you held the sector at Mamay, the nights you watched and wired and dug and piled sandbags on parapets? Do you remember the rats and the stench of corpses rotting in front of the frontline trench, and dawn coming, dirty white with the chill and a hopeless rain? Do you ever stop and ask, is it all going to happen again? Do you remember the hour of doom before the attack and the anger, the blind compassion that seized and shook you then as you peered at the doomed and haggard faces of your men? Do you remember the stretcher cases lurching back with dying eyes and lolling heads, those ashen grey masses of lives who once were keen and kind and gay? Have you forgotten yet? Look up and swear by the green of the spring that you never forget.
Powerful words of "Have you forgotten yet?" And clearly we have not forgotten. We continue to mark the silence every Armistice Day. And as we said, we will continue to do that for 100 years and more, we hope, in memory of those who fell in the First World War. However, this concert brings together two contrasting elements. One, the silence of the morning, that respectful, reverent mark of remembrance that we believe should continue, but also that in the afternoon, in the promotion of peace, we should bring musicians together in the only language that unifies us all, the language of music. Last year, we were delighted that Thorin Ferguson's piece, Armistice, was the music that musicians around the world united on, and we have new compositions to share with you today. I'm going to invite onto the stage Anthony White. Anthony is the composer of the first composition that our international orchestra are going to unite around today, and that piece is called Battling for Peace. And Anthony is very kindly going to give you some of the background to the inspiration for his piece. Ladies and gentlemen, Anthony White.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I just wanted to start off with my thanks. I want to thank Neil McLennan for his ongoing support over the past year, Thorin Ferguson, and the team at Craig Lockhart and Edinburgh Napier University. My extreme thanks go to Edinburgh Chamber Orchestra and to their fantastic conductor, Maestro Alberto Massimo. So my piece, Battling for Peace, is in three movements. The first movement is called The Spoils of War. I really wanted to depict the devastation and the carnage that war can wreak. This is dedicated to my grandparents who fought in the war, and is a very powerful opening piece. The second movement is called Reconciliation, and in its title, I wanted to depict the power of forgiveness, that we, you know, and amongst turmoil, you know, we have the power to forgive, hence through music. This is dedicated to my mum and my dad for their ever-ending kindness and love. The third movement is dedicated to all the I Play for Peace players across the world and to the Aberdeen musicians who participated in me on Wednesday. Thank you so much. This piece is much lighter and uses a quiet orchestration, but the whole essence of this one is just the kind of collaboration, being together. I Play for Peace has been an extraordinary project. Since its launch last year in 2018, it has brought hundreds, if not thousands, of musicians across the world together in unifying peace through music. Thank you ever so much, everyone, and thank you to the Chamber Orchestra and for Edinburgh Napier for having us here. Thank you very much. Hope you enjoy. Thank you.
goodness gracious me, not only a world premiere, but an outstanding one at that. Again, ladies and gentlemen, the Edinburgh Chamber Orchestra, Alberto Massimo and Anthony White. Thank you very, very much. Ladies and gentlemen, we were struck with a particular issue this year when we came to choosing our compositions. Because last year, we only thought we would have this concert as a one-off event to mark the armistice. But very quickly, it became apparent that musicians across the world wanted this to become an annual performance and to continue going with this. We put a call out for compositions for the piece, and we had seven outstanding compositions came forward. And I want to pay tribute to Thorne at that point, because a discussion was had as to whether Armistice should continue annually as being the single piece of music which musicians should play together. But Thorne had suggested, and bless him, that the humbleness and the willingness to share outwardly across the world. So why don't we every year continue to grow the compositions so that one of the real benefits of the project is the creative outpouring of new pieces of music. And you've heard one of those pieces of music today, just an outstanding composition from a young and very talented composer who's going to go very far. Our second composition has a very strong link to this building. We're delighted that we have renowned Scottish fiddler Paul Anderson with us, and his composition, which he's going to tell us more about himself because he can explain it far better than me, has a very strong link to the medics of the First World War. Ladies and gentlemen, can I introduce you to Paul Anderson? truly outstanding, Paul, and as we said, very, very appropriate for the venue we're in today. Thank you very much. Ladies and gentlemen, a number of thanks as we close today's concert for commemoration and for international peace. First of all, can I ask you once again to thank outstanding musicians from the Edinburgh Chamber Orchestra. We've been led, not only musically, but also with some history lessons thrown in as well, by the absolutely outstanding Alberto Massimo. To our three composers today, and the third one I'm going to tell you about in a second, our three composers today, Anthony White, Paul Anderson, and Claire Paddy-Salters. You've heard two out of the three pieces today. The third one I hope you'll listen to after the concert online. But just now, can we thank, first of all, Anthony White, a young composer. A young composer with a very bright future. A very experienced musician, but once again, an absolutely outstanding performance. And we're delighted you were here and delighted you could join us today on this powerful occasion. Paul Anderson. Can we thank once again the team at Edinburgh Napier University, Gary Seath? Can we thank Professor Paul Ferguson? And can we thank Dr. Kirsten McLeod and all of the team who've been supporting, not only for the concert to happen here, but for that concert to connect across the world. We've had musicians who've been joining us across the world. Again, Edinburgh Napier and Gary Seath, thank you very much. Can we thank all of our speakers today? I'm going to do this in a particular order. We're going to start off with the academic inputs. So my fellow academics, can we thank Professor Yvonne McEwen, whose tireless work on remembrance has in some ways sadly come to an end today, because today is the last of a significant series of events called Scotland's War, and the way in which Yvonne has brought together the country, not only in commemoration, but also in a forward-looking towards peace, has been truly outstanding. Can we thank Professor Yvonne McEwen? Here at Craig Locker, as we know, the work continues to promote remembering and understanding the past, and the champion of that, Catherine Walker, MBE. And most importantly, we pass the torch of remembrance from the generations that have gone before to the generations coming forward. Absolutely outstanding. Can we thank all three of our students from Sight Hill Primary School who've done outstanding today. Thank you. Can we thank you for also attending, the second year of this concert, and for your continued support of the work. Our final thanks goes to the final musician who played a part in the first piece and is going to finish the proceedings for the second year, the Lord Provost Piper, ladies and gentlemen, Lou Marshall. seen the power of music tonight. I hope you'll all join us for a reception after this concert down the stairs, kindly provided by the principal of Edinburgh Napier University, and very appropriately, Lou Marshall is going to pipe us out. Thank you.